Blackstone Audio presents Plunder, a Faye Longchamp mystery by Mariana Evans. This book is read by Cassandra Campbell. To Little Andrew and Avery.
Episode 1 of the podcast I never intend to broadcast. Part 1. By Amand Marie Landrenau. How long have I been stealing my grandmother's stories? I've been doing it longer than I've been telling my own stories, that's for sure. And I've been doing that for most of my 16 years. I don't remember falling in love with books. I just remember the boat rocking beneath my bed as Grandmère read me fairy tales. And I don't remember learning to read. It was a gradual thing, as if the letters on the pages of my picture books slowly came into focus day by day, materializing out of the fog as my grandmother spoke. Some days my nap time came and went without a book in sight, because Grandmère knew more stories than the Brothers Grimm. Her people, our people, have always lived here in the deep delta country, way below New Orleans and the between land where the Mississippi pours itself into the Gulf. If there is a story floating around about ship captains or long-lost lovers or endangered children or voodoo priestesses, and if my grandmother didn't tell it to me, then it isn't true. Or at least, it didn't happen anywhere near here. Young children like their worlds to be just so. It's less scary that way. So it bothered me that some of the stories she told me came out of thin air. All stories should be captured in books, or so it seemed to me. To fix that problem, I wrote my first story in the margins of a coloring book, one word on each page. Ship, gold, thief, kidnap. Quite a word for a preschooler, don't you think? Run home. All my stories end safe at home, just like that one. My social worker thinks this is significant. Well, duh. My mother ran away when I was 6 months old, and I've always lived on a houseboat that could have theoretically floated away some school day while I was learning things and playing kickball on the playground. After I wrote that immortal coloring book tale, Grandmère bought me a spiral-bound notebook. The blank pages made me happy, since I didn't like writing books with pictures that didn't match my story. Actually, I was tired of picture books in general. The drawings never matched what I saw in my head, and they took up space that could have been used for more words. I love words. They mean what they say, and they never change. You can trust them. I'm not even going to bother you with my social worker's interpretation of those last two sentences. You know what she thinks they mean. Sally, the social worker, says that recent events may put me in foster care for a while. Frankly, I'd rather just get started taking care of myself. I think I'd be pretty good at it, and I'm not sure I trust anyone else to do the job. Still, there are days when I feel like a little girl whose home floated away in the last hurricane. When I need something to hold on to, I've always reached for the 2 silver coins I found buried in mud, back when I was a little kid messing around the islands in my boat. I would hold them, one in each hand, and think, these must be worth something. If the houseboat and everything else goes back to the bank, I can sell these. With a silver coin in each hand, I'll never starve. Those coins are gone now. Stolen. I really need to go looking for more silver coins. Until then, I'll sit here, alone with my cheap digital recorder, and I'll tell it my grandmother's stories. Nothing else makes me feel quite so safe.
Chapter 1. The Gulf of Mexico lapped at Faye Longchamp's toes, as flawlessly blue as the water that wrapped around her home on Joyeuse Island. The waves splashed on her bare feet, blood warm, just as they did on her own beach. The scent of salt water was as familiar as the soap smell on her husband's neck. Strictly speaking, she wasn't really looking at the Gulf of Mexico. Faye wasn't sure how to name this water. In South Louisiana, the land just drifts to sea. The water at Faye's feet was connected to a bunch of canals and island-dotted estuaries and grassy coves that extended south and west until they eventually connected to Barataria Bay, and it was connected to the Gulf of Mexico. Regardless of its name, this water smelled like the Gulf breezes that blew in her bedroom window every morning. Faye had never traveled much. There had simply been no money. Starting her own archaeological consulting firm had held the promise of frequent business trips, paid for by someone else. What could be better than seeing the world and being paid to do it? This first out-of-state consulting trip had brought her here to South Louisiana, 500 miles from her front door, to a place that looked and felt pretty much like home. Maybe someday she'd land a client who wanted to send her someplace exotic, but not this time. This client had just called with a change in assignment, and Faye was still trying to wrap her brain around it. Everything had changed in the days since the Deepwater Horizon rig exploded and sank, though none of those changes were visible to the naked eye. Yet. The water at her feet was still just as clear. The sky was as blue. Pelicans flew overhead without a care in the world. Actually, one ripple from the offshore disaster had already reached shore. Fear. It showed on the faces of boaters at this marina, where a rented cabin served Faye as project headquarters. It showed in the reluctance of shoppers to part with money at the marina's tiny convenience store. It showed in the concern on the face of the marina's manager, Manny, as he stood at the cash register and surveyed an empty restaurant. It showed the most at the waterfront. Every time someone walked to the shore and stood there looking, as Faye was doing now, the fear showed. Joe appeared at her side. It was a comfort to remember how many times they'd stood on their own island and looked out to sea in just this way. He leaned down to speak in her ear so that she could hear him over the wind that whipped off the water hard enough to stir even Joe's heavy black ponytail. The unexpected endearment didn't come. Instead, he said, "We're out of bottled water to mix Michael's formula. I'll get some at the marina store."
Ah, romance.
Faye snaked an arm around his waist and rubbed her hand over the muscles of his flat belly, just to remind him that she was a girl.
"Grab some of that turkey he likes while you're there."
He put his lips next to her ear again, then headed for her neck.
"If I get sweet potatoes, too, he'll sleep better and longer."
Seduction between parents moves at lightning speed. It has to. There's no time.
Faye whispered, "If you get some of that microwave rice to go with it, he'll sleep till sunup."
And Joe was gone, making tracks to the convenience store so that they could carb-load their baby.
Faye was left to watch the setting sun bleed into the sea. Somewhere out there in the Gulf of Mexico floated actual blood and crumpled wreckage and a whole lot of oil. Before many days had passed, the oil would come here. Faye's job had become a race against time. Steve Daigle's wife was hardly cold in the ground. Actually, she was neither cold nor in the ground. He'd cremated the body, since it was the cheapest way to get rid of her, and that had just happened yesterday. He doubted she'd really have.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.